Our regular pastor, Ty Matoka, is at a family reunion in South Carolina this weekend. So he and his family are not with us. But I want to take the opportunity to welcome everyone here, particularly if you're visiting with us today. And I want to encourage our regular people to greet those visitors after church and say hello and show them what nice people you are. I especially want to welcome our visiting pastor today. Jason Driggers is here. He's from he's the head pastor at Redeemer Church in Saltillo, Mississippi. And there's a little about him in the bulletin that you can read. But we're really glad you're here this morning, Jason. We look forward to the message that he'll bring to us. Jason will also be preaching tonight, and I encourage everyone to come back tonight and hear him then and worship with us again. The only other announcement in the bulletin is our weekly prayer meeting at noon. There's a small group that meets every week at on Thursday. And if you can make that, it's a good thing to come to. So if there are no other announcements, let's take a few moments of quiet preparation to prepare ourselves for worship.
That Todd asked me to be here. Todd's a good friend of mine, and I was excited about being with you today. Why don't we stand and hear the call to worship from Psalm 150? Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with lute and harp. Praise Him with tambourine and dance. Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with sounding cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you'll remain standing and sing with us in your Trinity hymnal number 55, to God be the glory. reading of the law this morning comes from Romans chapter 13. I'll be reading just verses 8 through 14. Hear God's word. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know the time that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. So then let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies or drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The law, according to Galatians, was never intended to save. Its goal is to show us God's standard, and his standard is his character, who he is. And that is captured and reflected well in the law. When we read it, we are supposed to know that we fall short, and therefore that naturally leads to confession. So let's confess our sins together by reading the confession based on Psalm 51 that's printed there in your bulletin. O holy God, we humble ourselves before you this morning. We acknowledge our transgressions, and our sin is ever before us. Against you, you only, have we sinned and done evil in your sight. We confess our sins openly, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. We acknowledge that from birth we transgress your law, and from conception we sin. Have mercy on us, most merciful Heavenly Father, we pray. Amen. And because of the work of Christ being so sufficient to cover our sins, we every time we confess, we hear his pardon. And so I'll read for you God's pardon for your sin this morning. These are his words, not mine. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Amen. That truth is worthy of our praise. So why don't we stand and we'll sing a hymn of praise, hymn number 520.
God, my head.
If you would, please join me in our pastoral prayer. Oh Lord God Almighty, you said, let there be light, and day and night were born. And you said, let there be oceans, and the seas and the mountains rose up. And from a handful of dust, Lord, you breathed life into Adam, and you made men to worship you, to praise you, and to marvel at your goodness and mercy. Father, who are we to question you? Where were we when you told the oceans, here your proud waves stop? Where were we when you laid the foundations of the earth and determined its measurements? Which one of us here this morning, Lord, has entered the storehouses of the snow or seen the storehouses of hail? But Lord God, when we see the state of our world, when we see the evil at its worst, we wonder, Lord, and we ask, how long will you let Satan rage? Every week, Father, it seems that more men and women and children are shot or blown up or run over by trucks for absolutely no reason. How long, Lord, will you let this go on? Our policemen, Father, are ambushed and fear for their lives like criminals. Lawlessness increases and love grows cold. How long, Father, will you let violence rule? And when will justice be served? And in our community, Lord, in Columbus, this little conservative Bible Belt town, people are arrested every day for meth and drunkenness and drug abuse. We slept last night behind locked doors with our guns loaded, and our church's biggest need today, it seems, is security cameras and an armed guard. And Lord God, perhaps saddest of all, it breaks our heart to know that in some of our neighbors' homes, children cry themselves to sleep. They hunger for food and they hunger for friends. They're hungry for the love of a mother and father. How long, Lord, will children have to cry? How long will there be a need for Palmer Home and orphanages? So, Heavenly Father, we pray this morning that you would strengthen our faith. Show us that righteousness rules and teach us again about the love of Jesus Christ. Let us have forgiveness and mercy and the peace that passes all understanding. And assure us, Lord, that if the world seems to be falling apart, you're still sovereign in every way and in every situation. Lord, we know that you have not forgotten us. We know that we are precious to you. And Christ said, come unto me, all you that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Lord, our church this morning is half empty, and we pray that you would fill it with believers. Let this place be a refuge, Lord, of hope in this sea of sin and evil that's today's world. Father, we ask that you would protect our policemen and our soldiers. Keep them from harm even as they face dangerous situations. And we especially pray, Lord, for the men of this congregation that serve. Assure them and their families that the holy arm of God Almighty goes with them wherever they may go. And Lord, protect us in our homes. Keep us safe from the thieves and drug-addled criminals that have no respect for themselves or others. Especially, Father, we ask that you regard our elderly and the widows that live alone, like Miss Fran Perkins. Lord, for some of us this morning, the sin in the world is far away. It's overshadowed by our own personal sickness and pain. It's overshadowed by our wounds and our hurts. And so, Lord, we ask that you would ease our suffering, whatever that might be, and that you would make our burdens light. Especially, Lord, we pray this morning for little Astor Bragan, that you would bring him home quickly from the hospital, and that you would greatly bless Taylor and Lindsay. Lord, Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me. And we know, Heavenly Father, the compassion you have. So when there is no one to comfort those babies that cry, when there's no one to feed them or hold them, or when their fathers and mothers have abandoned them, we ask this morning, will you be their father? And will you love them when no one else will? Father, we ask today, holding firm to the promise of Jesus Christ, that he will return one day and make all things new. Forgive us, Lord, when we doubt, when we are weak, and strengthen us with the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, it was Jesus' blood that saved us, and it's his blood that gives us the right to pray. And so we say in his name, amen.
Our sermon this morning will come from 2 Kings chapter 5. I'll be reading the first 14 verses. Let me say up front that this entire chapter is a self-contained story. And so the second half of this, 15 to what, 23? No, much further down, 27, I'll be covering tonight. So I'd encourage you to come back and hear that. But for now, we'll read the first 14 verses of 2 Kings chapter 5. This is God's word. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and in high favor, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper. Now the Syrians, on one of their raids, had carried off a little girl from the land of Israel, and she worked in the service of Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "Would that my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria. He would cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman went in and told his lord, "Thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, "Go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So he went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothes. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, "When this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you Naaman my servant, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Only consider and see how he is seeking a quarrel with me." But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king, saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." But Naaman was angry and went away, saying, "Behold, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call upon the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. Are not Abana and Parpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. But his servants came near and said to him, "My father, it is a great word that the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Has he actually said to you, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. The grass withers and the flowers fade. Let me pray. Father, not my words, but yours. I pray this morning that you would pour out your spirit on us. Natural man cannot discern the things of heaven. We need your spirit this morning. Father, would that your people this morning hear that there is a preacher in God's house and be clean. I ask it for the glory of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who made it possible. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Well, a few words about narrative before we begin. The story structure of this chapter is often overlooked when you hear it preached, largely because if you're familiar with this text at all, you've probably heard the first 14 verses where Naaman is then cleaned and they stop. So stop where I stopped. And the rest of the passage is left off. But I want to point out to you an important fact. At the end of the chapter, we have another man who steps forward. And the whole chapter ends with this verse. "So he went out from his presence, a leper like snow." So my point, and I'll talk about that tonight, but my point right now is just that the chapter begins with a leper and it ends with a leper. And in technical terms, that's called an inclusio, or bookmarks. That's to tip you off that the story is now finished. And so if you stop at verse 14, you're missing some of the flow of this text and what it's trying to say. And you probably miss the main point if you just stop where I stopped this morning. It's a two-part chapter here. And so to lay out narrative for you, to kind of get you familiar with it, and I'm sure you are a little bit just from reading the Bible, but there is a certain pattern to all narrative. It begins with a sort of a once upon a time. And in this case, you've got the once upon a time being there was this great man named Naaman. And then you have an every day after that, this happened. And every day after that, Naaman's in this house and he's struggling because he's great, but he has leprosy. And even a little girl who's his slave longs for his healing. And then there's a turning point in the narrative. And the turning point is when everything changes. And that doesn't really happen until Naaman is cleansed. And then finally, after that turning point, you have a climax of the story, which is actually the end of this chapter. And then there's sort of an epilogue. Most people, though, and the reason I'm laboring this point is most people confuse the turning point with the climax. And so they think that Naaman's healing is kind of the climax of this story. That's the point of this text. To give you a modern illustration, have you all seen Rocky II? If you haven't, shame on you. This is an American classic. All the Rocky movies have the same plot, so we could probably say this about all of them. But I'll pick out Rocky II because it's really obvious. And if I spoil it for you, again, shame on you. You should have seen this by now in your life. But Rocky, in the first Rocky, the greatest Rocky movie, in my opinion, it actually won an Oscar for Best Picture. Rocky lost the fight in the first movie. So the second movie is just the same movie warmed over with a rematch at the end. But the dramatic tension that builds throughout this movie happens when Rocky agrees to fight this fight the second time. So once upon a time, Rocky was recovering from the first fight. And then one day, he agrees to fight the fight again. And so then dramatic tension begins to build. And if it's a good movie, which all Rocky movies are, by the way, you'll feel that tension just gain as the movie goes on. And you'll want release. You'll be sitting there thinking, something's got to give if it's good drama. If it's bad drama, you won't feel any tension and you won't want to watch it. But the real drama that starts to build in Rocky II is Adrian doesn't want him to fight. His wife does not want him to fight. And she argues with him about it and refuses to be ringside and support him the way she did in the first movie. A little aside, by the way, I have two kids. My daughter is now 10. But when she was about 6, I was watching the first Rocky movie. And she got glued to the TV at the end when he lost. And Adrian, of course, runs up to the ring. And he's all beaten up. And he's, Adrian! You know, calling her name. And she finally gets there. And she embraces, I love you, Rocky. And he said, I love you too. You know? And that was actually the point of the movie. You know, the whole movie, Rocky kept saying, I just want to prove I'm not a bum. And the answer to that was, you're not a bum if you're loved. That's gospel, guys. Well, Ruby, my daughter, sees that. And at the end of it, it just ends and starts fading to black. And she goes, she turns to me and she goes, that was a great movie. I said, I've never been prouder of you than right now. That's the point, guys. It's so obvious if it's done well that even a child will get it. And so now he needs that support again. Rocky's about to fight the rematch, but Adrian's not there. That is different than the first movie. What's worse is she gets sick and goes into a coma. And the tension builds even more because Rocky's training and he's terrible. He's lazy. His heart's not in it. He can't work hard at all. And everybody that's training him is telling him, you're just going to get killed this time, right? And then the turning point of the movie, which most people mistake for the climax, remember? The turning point, Adrian wakes up from a coma and she looks at Rocky and she says, win, Rocky. And then you hear the music kick in. Bum, bum, ba, da, bum, ba, da, bum, ba, da, bum. And Rocky's training and he's fighting hard. He's running fast. See, that's a turning point. Feels like a climax, though, because it's such an emotional high. And then the final, the battle at the end is actually the climax. Well, in this story about Naaman, the turning point is that Naaman is healed. It's an emotional high, but it's not the end of the story. But for the purposes of looking at this text in detail this morning, it'll be our ending point this morning. There's a point the Bible is making by showing us that a man like Naaman can be cleansed. That's very important for us to stop for a minute and reflect on before we move too far in the text. The Bible here says that Naaman was a great man, but this man's a Syrian. He does not belong to the people of God. In fact, he is one of the greatest enemies of the people of God. Naaman would have been a man who would have gone in other countries, and Israel was one of them, as we see from the text, and he would conquer them by force, and he was extremely skilled at that. He was very good at being a man of war. He was a military man. He was able to get a job done efficiently. In fact, he gained great renown for doing so. He was a man of valor, which means bravery. He was willing to go into the toughest situations and snatch victory out of the jaws of defeat. But Naaman had a fatal flaw. He was a leper. And often in the Bible, when you see that "but," something important is about to be said. That's what we have here. This man was a leper, and at that time, leprosy was a term used for a great range of physical ailments, but it always symbolically pictured death in Scripture. So essentially what the Bible is saying is that Naaman conquered life, but he couldn't conquer death. Death was pursuing him constantly. It was at his heels. And I'm sure as he gained in renown and as he gained in stature before other people, particularly the king here, he felt great pride in his accomplishments, but it was always sort of tainted by the presence of leprosy killing him slowly. Naaman, a great man in the eyes of his master with high favor, but a man who was dying. And to be a leper at this time was a shameful thing. In fact, he probably kept this information from most people as much as he could. He would have lost the respect of those he commanded. He would have lost the respect in the public eye of his people. And eventually, as you're probably well familiar with, by the time we get to the stories of Jesus, he would have had to have been banished, sent outside the camp. Naaman knew that, and he was scared. But because he did not belong to God's covenant people, the people of Israel, Naaman also did not know the God of Israel. And so Naaman came to the king here saying, as sort of a Hail Mary, "Hey, I heard something from the mouth of this little girl in my household." You can sense the desperation there, right? How many masters of the house would actually listen to their slaves for advice? But he's desperate. He needs transformation. He needs his life to change. And so you see here, in my opinion, what is a desperation plea to the king. I've got to do something, or this is going to take a bad turn very, very quickly. Syria had once defeated the Israelites in battle, and it's recorded for us in 1 Kings 20. And something interesting is said there, that they believed that the Israelites, when they faced the Syrians, actually the Israelites won this battle, and the Syrians couldn't figure that out because they were so mighty in war. So they kind of wrote it off, and they said, well, the God of Israel must have been the God of the hills. You see, at this time, to believe in God was to believe in nationalism. It was to believe in a projection of what your culture embodied. And every culture of this day and every nation of this day had their own deities. And the Syrians even believed that every god existed even over certain geography. There was a polytheistic worldview of impersonal gods. And they were capricious. You never knew what they would do, think, or say. And that's why Syria very comfortably here speculates on the will of God. They have no clue what God actually thinks. The Lord was arranging the events in Naaman's life, but he had no idea just how active the real God really is. As he sat there speculating on regional gods and national gods, he did not know the one true God. And this God had already planned a path for Naaman. And Naaman was about to experience him for the first time. And that's the important thing for us this morning. When we approach the God of the Bible, what does that look like? How does a relationship with God actually feel? How does it look as we come to know Him? Naaman will teach us, and I think that's why the story is recorded for us. But notice here, too, that we have a man that the Israelites would have hated. This was a man that would have come in from the outside and conquered the nation of Israel by force. That is not a person we would like. If that happened in America, this would be someone we would hate vehemently. This is not somebody that we would feel comfortable if they came to know God and repented and changed. You know, I think we've lost it over the years because we've read the text so much, but the Apostle Paul was also a man like Naaman. He was a man that was a great enemy of God's people. He hated Jesus Christ. He persecuted God's people. He fought hard against them. He dragged them off to jail. He imprisoned them, women and children, and he killed them. That is like one of the greatest terrorists of the day coming on national television and telling everybody, hey, I was wrong. Jesus Christ is the only way to God. It would rock the earth's foundations, culturally speaking. And honestly, the church was a little suspicious of Paul. Paul started preaching the gospel, and eventually the leaders in Jerusalem said, hey, come talk to us. They didn't trust him, and rightly so. How do you embrace an enemy? How do you embrace somebody who's killed your family members? How do you even begin to think that the gospel could apply to such a man full of hatred? I read a lot of commentaries in preparation for this, and a lot of guys said that Naaman was basically a good guy. They felt that they should honor him because he was so accomplished, but I think that's very American. In fact, what you have here is a man who, we're told explicitly, enslaved a little girl, dragged her off from her family, took her into his household. That's not meant to be a casual thing. That's meant to be a significant part of this story as we read it. That's horrible. And then one day, his greatest enemy, that little girl, said that she longed that he would know salvation. The people of God, pictured in this text, in a slave girl. See, this text is scandalous. It's scandalous in the Jewish culture that it was first presented to, because for one thing, women shouldn't preach the gospel. And we don't have here her preaching. That's not what I'm saying. But it's interesting that God chose the marginalized of that culture, the ones whose voices were never taken into consideration or heard. And it's from that person that he brings out the gospel, the hope, the grace, and the love. And yet the greatest man in all of the land at this time, a military commander of great might, could not see or feel what this little girl felt. He could not love his neighbor. He could only better himself on their backs. I think this is painting a picture that we should pause and reflect on. It's a picture of sin. It's a picture of what a life looks like when it's given over to sin. Sin is any want of conformity to or transgression of the law of God. I mean, sin is doing bad things against God or not doing what you should do in His presence. Offending God is a serious matter, though. It's not like when we offend one another. If I offend my wife, for example, I can just say, hey, I'm really sorry I did that. It's a finite instant, and it occurs in a fixed time against a finite person. But when you offend the God who created us, it is completely different. You offend an infinite person. And there is no, hey, let me just say I'm sorry. There has to be an infinite punishment. It is the only way justice can be met. But what we do with our sin is convince ourselves it's not that bad. The best way to manage the feelings of guilt that we carry and the feelings of shame that are pictured by leprosy here is we cover them up. I'm sure that Naaman wore long sleeves to cover up some of his sores, maybe a scarf, maybe a hat. I have a skin condition called psoriasis. It would have been considered leprosy in this day. It's not fatal, thankfully. But I know that tendency to want to cover up and the shame of just having exposure of your sore in front of someone who can see it. See, all of this is such an adequate picture for how we try to self-medicate and manage our sin. We cannot cleanse ourselves, so we cover up. How was Naaman covering up? Well, he was covering up with adequacy, wasn't he? If you looked at Naaman's life, he would have been the kind of guy that you would have wanted to be like. He was a man's man. He was a great man, a man of renown and valor. We all would have been impressed with Naaman if we met him today. We all would want to be like Naaman. All the men would want their lives to be like his. All the women would want to be with a man like Naaman. And yet what you have here is a man, according to God's perspective, who is desperately lost without hope. It is true that Scripture teaches that we, in response to the truth of God's existence and His way of salvation, we don't embrace it wholeheartedly. That is not our first response. Unfortunately, it's just not true that it seems so obvious that we should take this, but instead we fight against it. Romans 1 says that although they knew God, they suppressed the truth in unrighteousness. When I see the light, I pull down the shade. With great effort, I fight against accepting the truth of God in my life. That is my sinful response, and I can't stop it. I must be saved from it. All the time, I find myself living in what we now call, in our psychological terms, denial. It's a fancy word that just means I'm trying to cope with the brokenness by covering it up. In the Bible Belt, in a culture that has bought wholeheartedly into the idea that to be a Christian, you must be moral, in a culture that believes that in order for you to be a Christian, God must be pleased with your behavior in some way, shape, or form, we are most desperately fearful of this kind of vulnerability. We hide it. In a Bible Belt culture, one of the most scary things to face in your life would be the public exposure of your great sin. You see, no matter how adequate your life is this morning as you sit here, you also have a fatal flaw. You also have a deep brokenness and a deep need. Were it not so, go home. I have nothing to offer you. But I think you know better. The reason you're here is the Spirit has been working and that suppression of the truth has been cracked and chipped away at, and you're finally able to say, hey, I need saving. I need help. That is what the mark of a Christian really looks like. It is not someone who is good at covering up. It is someone who is willing to be exposed. That's what we're being told in this text. And that is what Naaman hates. And all of his adequacy and all of his sufficiency and all of his public attaboys and pats on the back, he could not stomach the reality that it was a farce, a ruse. And he was scared that they would see the man behind the curtain. Is that where you're at this morning? Is your fatal flaw on your heels just like it was with Naaman? Is it dogging you? I've been doing this job a while. It's impressive to me. 10 years I've been in rural ministry. That's what God called me to in my life. I'm a blue-collar guy. I grew up in a poor white home. I've lived in rural Kansas with farmers. I've lived in rural Appalachia with hillbillies. And now I live in rural Mississippi with God's people, right? But everywhere I've lived, I've seen the brokenness, the desperation, and it's growing. Drug addictions, pornography addictions, marriages falling apart. It's hard to counsel through a day of that. And as me and the elders of my session, as we meet and talk about it, we're often reminded it's so much worse out there than what we're seeing presented to us. Jesus called it whitewashing a bunch of tombs. The uncomfortable reality of the gospel is that fatal flaw is your entry point to knowing the one true God. But with everything in my heart, I want to hide that from you. It terrifies me. That's why Naaman got angry, you see. Naaman's avenue for salvation was influence and power and wealth. And so is ours. I counsel so many people who just financially are in debt, and all they do is worry about how much debt they're carrying, and they want control of their life, and they're seeking that salvation. But just like Naaman, over and over, they think they can purchase their way out of it. That will give them peace. But I've also known wealthy elitists, and all they do is worry about losing that money. It doesn't change. And you think, okay, well, I need to know the right people. I need to hang out in the right circles. See, that'll give me help. That'll give me aid. That'll give me influence. That'll cover things up. Naaman did too. Naaman hung out with kings, and they thought he was great. But it wasn't enough. I read different commentaries. I did some figuring up. Somewhere in the neighborhood of $6 million he took with him in today's currency to buy his cleansing. Every time you make effort to cover up, you're buying your cleansing. Every time you hide who you really are, you're buying your cleansing. But what the scripture is saying here is that you cannot be cleansed that way. Maybe you don't feel that way this morning. Maybe you're one of the rare few people that just everything is great. You're like the Lego movie. Everything's awesome. I really respect that. But if that's you, let me just tell you that's there because God says it should lead you to repent. Romans 2:4 says his kindness is meant to lead us to repentance. What if God allowed Naaman to be great in other people's eyes to prepare him for repentance? As Naaman knew everything was great, everything was awesome, he knew the deeper truth about his heart, that it was not so. So what happened? Well, he gets angry. Guys, it is a lie. And trust me on this. Salvation, it is not free. I know that sounds heretical, but it cost dearly. The good news here is it didn't cost you. It cost another man. What Naaman had to learn was, I think, the most uncomfortable truth about the Christian life that we labor under. It is the truth that I cannot cleanse myself. Some of you are closet addicts right now, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. I won't do it again. I'll start clean tomorrow. You have to understand that only God can change your heart. And all of your efforts that are done to make it look good externally will not produce that. But it's okay. It's okay. Because God did not die for that person you're trying so hard to be. In fact, that ideal person will never exist. See, what we've done with Christianity in America is we've said, and we hear it on the TV, we hear it in sermons all the time, that God wants to make you the best version of you that he can possibly make. That is not true. That version that you have in your mind, you know, for me, I'd like to lose about 80 pounds. Slim, sexy Jason, you know, that's the guy I want to be to everybody. That guy, he's an idol. Not because it's not good to lose weight, but because my whole salvation is wrapped up in my image and looking good before you. But I don't care a thing about looking good with him. The fatal flaw. When you sin, are you more afraid of us finding out or of God? My friends, if you're motivated by the first, that's not Christianity. The Bible is saying the greatest problem we face today is our heart. It's who we are before him. Salvation is actually very free because someone else paid the cost. There was another commander of the Lord's army who stepped into this story. He came not for his own cleansing, but for yours. He had done nothing wrong. He had no need to be washed. John the Baptist argued with him about that and said, I have need to be baptized by you. And he said, no, let it be so that we might fulfill the law. Jesus Christ was willing to be washed in your failure, your mistake, your fatal flaw. And he had done nothing wrong. And it wasn't enough that he just be punished. He had to bear an eternal punishment. But he was the only one who could because he's infinite. And I don't know how. We can't explain it. But on that cross, 2,000 years ago, the entirety of the wrath of God for an eternity was met in him. He bore it all for you. Now, my friends, that's a cost you'll never fully understand. Do you understand that? That this morning, a finite mind cannot wrap itself around the idea of paying an infinite punishment? We'll never even know what that means, I think, in glory. The cost was much more than $6 million, was it not? You see what Naaman's doing? He's offering a paltry ransom. It's a king's ransom in our eyes. It's a paltry ransom in God's. Here is the good news. Here is the gospel. You need nothing. You bring nothing. And he accepts nothing. Everything I do to try to impress you guys does not work when I translate it into my relationship with God. He is not impressed because he loves me. my son, Lincoln. He's 7. And we recently moved to a different house in town, bigger house. I was carrying boxes out to the moving truck, and Lincoln walked beside me, just struggling with a box. And he said, "Look, Dad, I'm helping. Aren't you proud?" And I just smiled. But a tear started coming to my eye because I thought, how will I ever be able to teach him that he doesn't have to lift a finger to make me proud? I'm proud because he's mine. He's my son. When Naaman brought this king's ransom to God, God was being painfully obvious about the fact that it was insulting. He let Elisha stay in the house. He didn't even send Elisha out. And Naaman got the message. It made him mad, didn't it? I thought he was going to come out and put on this grand display. See, Naaman's used to what we do when we're impressed with one another. Oh, let me shake your hand. I'm so honored to have you here, right? God's not that way. There's two ways you can go with that this morning. You can be very insulted like Naaman is, that he's not impressed with you. Or you can get clean. You have to begin to understand that it is that radically free for you. If you can accept that this morning, it means you're also accepting that it was so greatly cost. Just horrible cost. Nightmarish, hellish judgment for him. Jesus got nothing out of this relationship. The Bible says that while you were his enemy, he died for you. I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't hand Lincoln over to anybody, much less someone who hates me. God loved you so much that you were worth that to him. You, as you really are this morning, not the you you're trying to be, not the you we know, but the you that you see when you're honest with yourself, looking in that mirror. That's who God loves. And it is so scandalous and such the opposite of what we expect from every other relationship in our life, that it's offensive. Every relationship for us has some payoff, right? Every relationship I enter into, I'm getting something out of it. So it's so hard for me to understand why God would love me and get nothing. This was such a difficult doctrine for the Jews, the people of God. Isaiah talked about this and he said, "He will become a sanctuary, a stone of offense and a rock of stumbling to both houses of Israel, a trap and a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem." See, what happened was it was so free, they couldn't accept it. They had to add something in. Can I do this? Can I be that? Can I be a child of Abraham and that'll get me some points? Can I go to church every Sunday? Aren't you impressed that I'm a pastor, Jesus? Aren't you impressed? Can I throw something else on top? Hey, I'm adopting. Isn't that cool? Aren't you impressed? See, it's just our natures, guys. We do this. What I'm saying is the gospel by nature is free, and that's very offensive. So much so that we'll trip over it. It'll be easy to do. And Naaman was tripping over it. Notice it's the slaves in this story who get it right. The kings don't. The military men of great might don't get it. It's the slaves. It takes humility. It takes being brought to a place in your life where you're desperate enough to get clean. And Naaman really was. Even though he was angry, he fought through the anger and he got down in that water. And he was healed. What about you this morning? Are you desperate yet? Has God brought you to a place in your heart where you're willing to be a scandalous sinner in the eyes of others to receive cleansing in your heart? We have done a disservice as pastors. I feel like every time I speak at a church, I have to do this on behalf of the pastors. Just got to say I'm sorry. We've told you that God will make your life wonderful. We've told you that He'll make you sexy and wealthy. We've told you that Christianity will make you better than people around you. And we've lied for years. Because the head of the church was a man of sorrows. And no one esteemed him highly. He wasn't good looking. He was rejected. He was abused. He was neglected. He was punished. And even by his closest friends, including me, he was abandoned. When you're doing this right, when you really embrace this God, everything else will fall away. Everything else will be put in its proper place, and you'll begin to see the king's ransom is just paltry. But you will gain. Remember, Peter sort of kind of tried to brag to Jesus one time. He said, "Hey, I left my family behind for you, man. What are we going to get?" Jesus didn't discourage that. Did you notice that? Instead, he said, "You've not lost anything that you'll not get back 100-fold. Talking about story structure, right? Let's say we close the book right now. Guys, if you look at your life right now and judge your entire life by what it looks like right now, which is what American culture does, it's like reading halfway through a story and closing the book. Jesus is saying to you, you will not lose anything in this life that he will not be able to return to you 100-fold, including family and friends. But are you desperate? Do you want to be clean? Jesus Christ was willing to live the life of a nobody to get you. If you are to be made in that image, so too must we do likewise. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for your Son and his willingness to go into the camp of the enemy, to be cleansed by his blood. Lord, this morning we sit here receiving that grace and mercy, and yet we don't even understand it, just like Naaman. Naaman came out of that water. He had no way of explaining how that happened, but he did profess faith. He said, "Surely the God of Israel is the one true God." Father, this morning, for a people who are constantly pulled aside by the idols, looking good and covering up, would you bring us to that place of desperation where we know the true God? Cleanse us this morning. So many of us are enslaved in our hearts, and we need to be set free. Father, I thank you that that freedom has already been purchased. And because of that, we know we can have it right now. They can go out of here today and know with certainty that they are clean. Give them that assurance. I believe the whole Bible is written for that purpose. Assure our faith this morning. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved. I see.
Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. So they shall put my name upon the people of Israel, and I will bless them. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.